Okay, so today we are looking for an eigenvalue buckling analysis. In our past session, we have discussed about the theory behind that eigenvalue buckling analysis. In this session, we will see about how to do that eigenvalue buckling analysis on a tower structure in Ansys Workbench. So first, what I will do here is, and you know that eigenvalue buckling analysis cannot be done as a standalone system. So we have to do a pre-stressed condition. So a pre-stressed condition means a static structural. So first we need to perform a static structural. In that static structural, you have to define whether this analysis is a linear analysis or non-linear analysis, and the boundary conditions you need. So whatever the loads and fixed supports and the degrees of freedom, everything will be defined in the static structural environment. And after that, you need to couple the eigenvalue buckling analysis on the solution of a static structural analysis. These entire data will be transferred to the eigenvalue buckling analysis. So you can't perform an eigenvalue buckling analysis by a standalone one. Okay, so if you want to define that engineering data, you can double tap on the engineering data. Engineering data entities will be open. You can add the whatever the material you need. So in this analysis, I use a structural steel, so that is a default material, so that I don't need to open the engineering data. So I can directly go for geometry editor, that is design modeler. So just double tap on the geometry. Okay, so far we have completed our geometry editing part. So all we need to do here is we need to just assign a cross section. So it may be any cross section for the study purpose. So for that, I just go to concept. You will have an option called cross section. I use a rectangular cross section. So if you want L section, so L section is the standard cross section which is used for tower structures. If you want, you can use it also. I use rectangle. The size should be 2 mm cross 2 mm, because our dimension is very small, so that is why I am using a very minimum number of size. And select all the 10 bodies and say the cross section should be rectangular one. And if you want to look at that cross section, you can always go to the view option, enable cross section solids. So in the meanwhile, if you want to use that L session, you can always use L session also. That is not an issue. Please make sure that you have a 10 bodies, but it is a single component. So that what I will do here is just select all the bodies and say right click. You will have an option called form a new part. So what does it means right now means these 10 bodies is considered as a one part. What happen if you go back to that, get back to that mechanical itself? When you have a 10 parts and 10 bodies, it is consider, you will get an error called pivot warning. So already in our past videos, we already get that error. So that make sure that you are having one part and 10 bodies, okay? So make it as a single part. So after you are doing all the works, just close this design modeler and double tap on the mechanical. So model, so you will get mechanical is get started. So all you need to do here is you just assign the boundary conditions, whatever we need over here. Okay, so our model is imported over here. So first I will reset the layout, reset layouts, and say I just right click and say generate mesh. So you will get a mesh like this. It's an 1D mesh, so you don't worry about that counts of the mesh. So obviously it is within the limit, so there is no issue at all. And always check the geometry whether it is having a volume and masses. Okay, so everything is fine. So at least you have a positive value. So in case we have negative value or else zero, so that means there is an error in your geometry. Okay. So after that, if you want to perform a free run analysis, whether your all joints are connected or not, you can perform. but I don't want to perform here. I just directly go for that analysis. So right click and say insert a fixed support. So I will fix the bottom side. So it's a completely arbitrary. So whatever the boundary condition, you can apply over here. So I just randomly apply the boundary condition and right click insert a force. So I apply a force on this supports. Okay, so make sure you are in the vertex selector. So 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I will upload apply a point load which is in the direction of y. Maybe the value may be 1500 newton, and the direction should be this. So the bottom, okay, so the forces should be exactly applied on the four corners. So why? Because the wire is actually carried out like this, right? So from here to here a wire, and from here to here, and always from here to and here. So here and here and also here. So it should be shown like that. So that is why you have a force which is like that. After that, I will apply a tentative loads like this and this. We will observe how the buckling will be happened in the structure. What is it buckling factors? Okay. For that, I use a random force at this. Okay, so I just select these edge. Okay, not this edge, this four corners, and click on apply, and the magnitude should be 600 newton, and it should be in this direction. So it should be a compression load, okay, so not a tensile load. So for a buckling analysis, we need to give a compression load. Also in this point I need to apply another force. It's completely arbitrary. There is no rule at all. So just make sure you're on the vertex selector and click on apply. Maybe a 750 newton. The force should be this direction, and click on apply. Okay, so we give a fixed support and three forces. So 1 and 2 and 3. So the next thing is I don't need any solutions at all. So I just click on solve. So because it's a pre-stressed condition, my need is we need to define the fixed support and then forces at all. So that is all for this analysis. Okay, so everything is fine. I just close this thing. Okay. So now we get a pre-stressed condition. Okay. So we need to couple the eigenvalue buckling analysis to this set of analysis. So it's very simple. So just drag and drop the eigenvalue buckling analysis to the solution itself. So now we will get a coupled analysis. Okay. So these entire data will be transferred to the eigenvalue buckling analysis. And click on the setup. Now starting mechanical will be initiated. Okay, so once you open that, so your structure is imported. So you will get that static structural is also there, and eigenvalue buckling analysis is also there. So first right click the solution and say solve. These entire data will be get solved again, and the data will be completely transferred to the eigenvalue buckling analysis. And you will also notice that the pre-stressed condition right now, it is a static structural one. Okay, so that means the entire boundary conditions are applied on the static itself. Suppose if you want to convert the static structural into a non-linear analysis, you don't have any option to change the eigenvalue buckling analysis as a non-linear one. Suppose if you want to change it, you just click on the static structural analysis settings. In that analysis settings, you'll have an option called large deformation. So if you turn on it, your problem is get converted into a non-linear analysis. Okay, also if you want to include that inertial relief effect, you can turn it on. Okay, so this is the only way to convert your analysis into a linear into non-linear one. always you have a lot and lot of non-linearities, like material non-linearities, geometrical non-linearities, and then contact non-linearities. It is one of the non-linearity that is based on the geometrical shape having a large deformation. That is why you are enable it, and still you have to change that by using another method. By changing the material, you can always go to the materials. You can assign a material. See, right now the material should be structural steel. So if you want to assign a non-linear material, your problem will be converted into a non-linear one, since you included that curve called stress versus strain curve. So usually in linear analysis, these curve cannot be included. So that is the only difference. Fine. So the next thing is, it's very simple. Just click on the analysis setting. All you need to do here is just enter the mode shapes you needed. So already you know that what is mode shapes, why we need to enter this. So if you still having any confusions, just watch our theory session. In our theory session, we clearly explain about that eigenvalue buckling analysis, what are the factors we need to give in this analysis, why we do that also. Okay, so I just input a value called 12, and also I don't want to change any output control, so I need a 12 shapes. Okay, so that is all we need. 12 shapes means 12 buckling factor, BFC, that is buckling BLC, buckling load factor, so BLF. So we are only looking for the least one value, so in that value the buckling will be happened. Okay, good thing. So the next thing is, all you need to do here is just click on solve. Now your problem will be get solved. So just click on the solution. You will get a graph like this. So all the values are which is nearby 1. So exactly that means a buckling is actually happened over here. If you get a value which is less than 1, a buckling is surely happened over here. So just create mode shape results and click on solve. You will observe the shapes. So how it is actually buckled. See, your structure will be buckled like this. Okay, so if you need a proper animation, go to the result and just turn off the mesh outline. That is, right now the mesh elements is shown, so just click on no wireframe. You will get a clear image over here, and say click on OK. Now you will get a clear images. Okay, so it's just a tentative value. It's not an actual deformation. It just give you an ideal idea about how it actually deforms. So it doesn't matter how it actually moves. Okay, so we are only looking for this value. Okay, so how it is actually deforms. So it's very close to 1, so that means the applied current load is enough to buckle this component. Okay, so either we need to reduce that forces. So what I will do here is, so I just reduce the forces to 1500 to maybe 500 newton, and just click on solve. And also I reduce this factor also 600 to 200 and click on solve. So before get solved, you need to delete the existing results. So right click and say delete, and after that you need to solve it. Good. So our result will be get solved, but now this time when I reduce the load, our buckling factor will be, load multiplier value will be increased. So in the previous cases you will get a value of 1. What does it actually means? Now this time you will get a value of 2.3158. what does it means? Okay, so when I open the calculator, so in our theory session I already discussed about it. A buckling load factor, so this is what a buckling load factor, a load which is required to buckle my component. So buckling load, so B load, what is it, that buckling load? So a buckling load means the load which is required to buckle my component. So how can I calculate that? So you will get a buckling load factor, right? So that is 2.318 into applied load. So how much load I can apply? For example, if I applied 1500, you get a factor of 2.318. that means you need additional of 2.318 times of 1500 newton. Okay, so to buckle your component. Okay, so for example, right now I get a value of 2.3185. 2.3185 into applied load. That is 600, I think so. If you click, so you need 1319.1 newton load to buckle this component. So if you get a less than one value over here, your component is surely buckle. Okay, so always we need to increase this value, whether your component is sustainable or not. You can check the value. So if you get a more than one value, it is good. So we recommended at least you have to be in the safer zone. You get a value more than 4. So if you get a value more than 4, you are on the safer side. Okay, so nearby 1, 2, 3, it's a little bit tricky, but it's up to the certain cases whether you need. If you want, you can accept, or else you can change the design configuration, or else you can increase the cross-sectional size, whatever it is, you can perform over here to increase the buckling load factors. Okay, so it's a very simple analysis, very easy and very effective one, a quick analysis with having a maximum result accuracy. So not a accurate result, it's a tentative one. Although while comparing to that time factor, it's an excellent result. Okay, so it takes 5 to 10 minutes of analysis to calculate that buckling factor. It is a theoretical value, but it almost is same. Okay, so if you need an accurate result, more accurate result, up to 80 to 85%, 90% of accurate result, you can go for nonlinear analysis. Okay, and hope you will get this point and try it yourself. And if you have any doubts, let me know in the comment section, and we will meet on our next session. Okay.